What's good, everyone? My name's Kyle, and I'm at the NSBE 43rd National Convention with Bugsy right here.
That's right.
We just got out an interview or a panel or something with Jack Dorsey, the CEO of Twitter.
Very, very impactful.
Real impactful.
I'm a little spy right now.
I use the generic batteries on my camera, though, so I'm sorry, but it dies towards the end, but we got most of it, so be sure to check it out.
That's right.
I taught myself how to program when I was about 14 years old, when I'm from St. Louis, Missouri, in the city, and I was just fascinated by how the city worked, and I wanted to see the world, and I wanted to see it on my computer screen. And my parents had a police scanner, and they had a CB radio, and I would listen, and I would put these into the program that I was building, and I could actually watch them across the city, and I just thought it was the coolest thing ever. So we all came together somehow at a company called Odeo, which was a podcasting company. And this is a very unique way to start a company such as Twitter, but we came together to serve this podcasting idea, but it wasn't really going that well. And when I joined, about 2 months after I joined, Apple released their podcast directory, which pretty much took the entire reason for being a company away. So we started searching for new ideas, and text messaging, I know this is crazy to think about, but text messaging was just getting big in the United States in 2006. And we were all on our phones, and it was extremely costly to do back then, but it was a fascinating thing. So came up with this idea where what if I could use my phone and I could broadcast where I was, and anyone could follow that. And brought it up during a hack week, and was given 2 weeks to build a prototype. And we built a prototype, and it just felt amazing. And it was all text. It was all 160 characters at a time. We didn't start with 140 characters. Little by little, we invited the whole company, which was probably just 17 people at that point. And day by day, we just fell in love with this thing, and we didn't know what it was, and we didn't know what it was going to be, but it felt really good, and we just wanted to make it better and better every single day. And that's what we did, and little by little, we took resources away from Odeo, and we invested more of our time into Twitter. So, you know, Twitter didn't start as a company, it started as an idea out of a failing company, and because of that, it just created a very, very different dynamic than you would expect for most startups. So it's a pretty unique story, and not something that can be easily replicated. But it was something that we wanted to use, and that's what really drove it. And then we became really good listeners as to how people were using it, and we made it easier. So everything you see in Twitter today, the at symbol, the hashtag, the retweet, and now tweet storms are things that, even the word tweet, are things that the people on Twitter created,
right.
And
so
we made it easier.
We have a picture of, for those of you who haven't seen it, that back when Twitter didn't even have handles, took us a while to find this picture. I didn't even know that Twitter could look like this, so.
Pretty
ugly. We've come a long way.
Come a long way. There's actually earlier pictures too. If you want to go on Flickr and search for my account, we have all the earliest screenshots, which looks even worse than this.
So users started using the hashtag, creating the hashtag, using the words tweet, retweet. So in the beginning stages, what were some interesting examples or those pivotal moments where it was like, wow, this is how users are using the platform?
Well, the first was, you have to start with yourselves. You have to start with what you know, and the first was us. Like, I remember the first day that we got SMS turned on, and the magical moment for me was an SMS back then was extremely complicated to work with, and it was really janky, and it was kind of a big hack. It barely worked, but it worked enough that we could actually use it, and I remember when we turned it on so that you could actually, we didn't call it tweet back then, but actually send a message to Twitter via your SMS phone. And that allowed us to go anywhere in the city, and as soon as we tweeted something, then it would go out to everyone who was following me. And vice versa for Viz and Ev and everyone in the company, Crystal, Jason. And what was great is we left work that day. It was around 7 to 8 p.m. we all did a thing, and you know, Ev went to dinner, and I went to yoga, and Jason did something, and we were all updating what we were doing, and our phones buzzed as soon as people were typing, and it was just the coolest feeling, because even though we were all over the city, it felt really small, and felt like we were together. And then that translated to the next moment where we felt, you know, there's this earthquake in San Francisco, which we have a lot, and we were, you know, I was working in the office, I think it was a Saturday, and Biz was somewhere, and Ev was somewhere, and all over the place, and I got a buzz on my phone, and it said earthquake, and then it, I got more of them, earthquake, 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 and then it was like, you know, I think it's a 3.7 out of Richmond, and now I think it's out of Berkeley, and it's 5.6, and within minutes, someone reported that the USGS just reported that it was a 4.7 out of Richmond, and it was just amazing to go from speculation to fact in that time frame. But more importantly, you know, it could have been a big thing. It could have been something that was scary. It was scary when we first felt it, but again, you didn't feel like you were alone. You felt like you were going through something with someone else, and it didn't matter where we were physically. You just had that feeling of smallness. So that was for us, and then, you know, we just saw all these experiences where the world was using it in very similar ways. These are huge events, whether they be protests or natural disasters or sporting events or just watching a television show, where people are using it to get together and to talk about something that's happening live, something that's happening in real time. It was this really interesting connection. We couldn't really figure out what the magic of it was, but I think, you know, that if there's one word that really describes the success of what we've done and what Twitter is the word open. Open makes it public, makes it fast, makes it so that anyone can communicate with anyone else, and anyone using the tool as a microphone has a potential that anyone in the world can see. It doesn't always happen, of course, but it has a potential. And we saw that play out too. You know, there was this plane that landed in the Hudson. This guy with 60 followers was there at the right time. He tweeted a picture of this plane landing in the Hudson, and within 10 minutes, it was picked up by CNN, went around the world in those 10 minutes. 60 followers. So it wasn't a matter of like who follows you. It was a matter of like,
or a verified check mark.
Or a verified check mark. Thank you very much. So it was just a matter of being in the right place at the right time and having access to this microphone that could reach the world. And that was just such a powerful concept. And over time, we've added more and more people, and that gets more and more complicated. So our challenge now is, you know, how do you find what matters most, and how do you find what's most relevant in real time? So you still have that feeling of electricity, you still have the feeling of closeness, you still have the feeling of conversation, but you're getting to what matters immediately, and then really making sure that you can dive in deep to the conversation. So, you know, if there was ever a thing as a people's news network, that's what I think Twitter is, and it's extremely powerful, and I don't think there's anything else like it in the world.
I think it's great. So Leslie, Twitter's first CMO, came in, chief marketing officer, and she's wonderful, just came in with this vision. And one of the things that she says when you walk in the Twitter building, she was like, we have to get rid of these walls and 50 shades of gray and 50 like Twitter blue, added color. So you see more color with Twitter, and it's what's happening. And I remember she said once, this is the first time that Twitter has said what we are and we're what's happening right now. So we get the question a lot, you know, where are we going? So what's the future of Twitter? What is Twitter focused on?
Yeah, I mean, so we're, to answer that question of like, you know, we want to be the place that when you have a question, which is fundamental, what's going on, Twitter is the first place that you check. So that's goal number one, is when it's kind of like you hear commotion, you hear noise, you hear a siren out the window, you hear it across town, and you rush to the window to see what's going on. Twitter should be faster than you rushing to that window. We should be delivering a notification before you even get up out of your couch. And that's really challenging to do, but we have the information. We just need to make sure that we're connecting the dots. So instead of it just being the first place that you check, being the first place that you hear of anything, and you hear of anything that's going on in the world. So that means that we need to be really good at understanding an individual and what they care about and what matters to them, And then we have a very high bar for being able to push information to them before they even know that they need it, before they even knew that it mattered to them. And again, we have the context, we have the information. We just need to make sure that we're connecting the dots, and that's, you know, that's the technology that we now need to employ. And we have some of the best machine learning folks in the world who are working on this problem. But it's a big problem to do in general, but it's even bigger problem to do it in real time, to do it live, and to make sure that it's not spreading misinformation. It's actually giving people something that matters, that gets them closer and closer to truth, that they can, you know, have a conversation around and have dialogue in. So I think that's number one, is just being that the first place to hear of anything that's going on in the world. We're building utility that people find daily value out of. And then, you know, in terms of tweeting, you know, we started with text messaging. That was a prevalent technology, and now there's better technologies. Now there's video. Now there's images, and we need to make sure that we're always providing the fastest way to capture what's going on, and capture what's happening, and then doing the right things to find meaning, to find what's most important in that, and then enabling it to be broadcast to the world or to the audience that really matters to you.
Yeah, absolutely. I know for myself, like in the military, it's a really big thing to be close to the news, what's going on, what's going to be the next trigger to send you somewhere for conflict. And Al Jazeera and CNN were my go-tos for my news. And it's interesting now, it's Twitter, and the only reason now I watch CNN is to see Angela and Bakari. So that's basically it. And I usually watch them on my Twitter feed and my timeline because everybody keeps me informed of when Angela is doing her thing on CNN. So we're gonna go into quickly the, we have a video, because we just wanna add context to the For the Culture series that we did during Black History Month, where we had these influencers. And just to let you know like how important this was, is my team came up with this strategy. University recruiting, we wanted to expose students, and what's really interesting is this didn't even come from we have a dedicated university recruiting team. This actually came from the team that's responsible for engaging with students on campus, and they came with a strategy and they were like, this is what we want Jack to do. And I was like, okay, we want Jack to send 15 DMs to these influencers and fight it. And we asked, and Jack did it. You can ask them, Jack DM them, and it was really funny to see some of their reactions. Be like, Jack DM me, yes, whatever you need, we'll do it. And it was just important to have this conversation and dialogue. But the beauty of it, and I would love for you to pay attention to the video, is that this was Twitter celebrating Black History Month, acknowledging the influencers on the platform, but the room wasn't just filled with Black students. It was filled with everyone who wanted to come and celebrate and acknowledge that with us. So take a look at the video, and then we'll have our influencers come up. So thank you everyone for joining us. And so we're just gonna jump right into it. But first, we pulled some data and stats. In the last 30 days, these four influencers alone have had over 86 million impressions. So that's just in the last 30 days of the reach of just these four influencers. So and each of you come from different spaces of how you use Twitter. But we'd love to just start with Angela. So for those of you who don't follow Angela Ryan on Twitter, you need to. And if you don't, you can, all their handles are up here. And Angela, you had quite the week, the past week.
No, Joe Walsh had quite the week. Hey!
So talk to us about how you are working with your organization, your company, and then you're on scene and you have these moments, and then how that comes out on Twitter, or how you engage Twitter with the conversation.
So I don't know that the company that I have is a political strategy firm. Unfortunately for me, all of my clients knew exactly who they were getting when they hired me. So there's not been any real issue there. And furthermore, they've been really supportive of the work I've been able to do on air, whether it's CNN or Breakfast Club. I didn't know so many white folks watch Breakfast Club videos, by the way. Which is cool, but that's great. Diversity matters. But I think that for me, particularly this week, it was hard. Like, I'm not really celebrating the moment for being on air because I saw one of my mentors, my very first job in politics was with Maxine Waters. Y'all have been like, oh, she's so good. Where's she been? She's been like that, y'all. She's been like that. And to see her get attacked, talking about a damn James Brown wig from Crazy Bill O'Reilly was just, I was already over it. And then to watch what happened with April Ryan, who is like our sole representative, basically, and has been for decades at the White House, to see her be kind of talked down to like Sean Spicer thought that was his child. And then to have my own moment first on Twitter with someone who I don't believe, Jack, I tweeted you about this, I don't think he should have a Twitter account. He said things like Barack Obama should watch his back after the Dallas shooting. He said things like he's gonna get his musket if Hillary Clinton won the election. Like, he's violently ignorant. And so I told him that he was a bigot, and I resented the fact that I had to do that not just on Twitter, but the next day on air. So I was pissed by the time I got to that moment, so much so that, just frankly, I will tell you all, I cried after that segment. And I said it on the video, and I'll say it again now, one of the best things to me about Twitter is even when there's not somebody to give you a physical hug, all of my mentions were like, we stand with you, we know exactly, and I'm not talking about just black folks, I love y'all, but there were white people and Asian people and people from South Africa and people in Australia. I mean, just saying like, you said exactly what needed to be said and we relate to it. So those are the moments that make it worth it. But it was a hard one.
Right. But then what also came out of it, so Brittany, then you tweeted hashtag
yes,
Black Women at Work. Black Women at Work. So,
Well, you know, first I want to acknowledge, I was telling Jack this is the first time that I've been in Kansas City since August 9, 2014, which was the day Michael Brown Jr. was killed. I am a native St. Louisan, just like Jack, and also Maxine Waters, must be very clear, we breed a certain kind of person in St. Louis. And I was here and was supposed to be here for the whole weekend. I was speaking to a conference of young girls and decided to go back early on August 10th join with the people outside of Ferguson PD as I was raised to do. And that was a time for me in which Twitter really started to transition things because it was about truth telling, right? I found out about Michael Brown Jr. not from the news because the news was not reporting it then. I found out from social media. And I knew that Twitter, Instagram, these other platforms were going to tell me the truth that other people wouldn't. And that is how we have come to rely on Twitter, especially in the activist space. And so being able to tell that truth was the same sentiment that I wanted people to take on when I asked folks to tweet their Maxine and April moments using the hashtag Black Women at Work. It wasn't the first time that the hashtag had been used, but I hadn't seen the hashtag before, and so I wanted to at least start a conversation because folks were outraged as if this didn't happen in our own workplaces every single day. And it's like, I'm glad that you are finally standing up for Black women because Lord knows you have not had enough of that over time. But let's not pretend like you don't work with April and Maxine and Bill and Sean every day. Let's not pretend like you often sit silently or don't even notice the microaggressions or macroaggressions, let's be clear, that are happening all around you. And so I wanted to, as my colleague Sarah says, help make the invisible visible, which is what this platform so often allows us to do. And so, you know, it meant that when we were watching CNN later that night with Simone and Angela, we were all right there. There were people that were watching that segment with fresh eyes who recognized that this wasn't a rarity, but that this was something that we deal with all the time.
Absolutely. And what's so interesting is within the Twitter culture, you can imagine, like, if it's happening on the platform, like I said, we're always on our phones, it's all on our computers, and it even started a discussion for us. And people were like, hey, this is trending, what is it? And I tweeted, I'm about to like every single hashtag Black Women at Work tweet. And it started a conversation for us on our teams and even at Twitter. So just talking about, I think that's just culturally really powerful about Twitter is that, you know, we have hashtag Ferguson on a wall on Twitter.
still there. We've had hashtag Black Lives Matter on a wall. And so it's a part of the culture of what happens on the platform, and it evolves. So I want to turn to Jamila. Mini Mila, a celebrity on Twitter. Mini Mila here up in the front. But you, what I've really appreciated about your engagement with the platform, I see you as, I always go to Jamila's timeline when I'm looking like right now, this whole female perspective on the Kendrick Lamar lyrics and stuff. If you're not following, it's trending. So how do you involve and engage the conversation? Because I see you going and inviting yourself into the conversation to show that perspective and share that. So talk about that a little bit.
You know, in my career, and I started with a blog, I did not plan to be a media executive or a journalist at all. But one thing that I realized very early, and I started writing around 2007, taking it pretty seriously by 2009, was that I don't think I'm the best writer in the world. I'm not looking at James Baldwin or you know, Ida B. Wells as a goalpost, but I found that there are a few groups that I belong to, Black women in particular, especially millennial Black women, that really identify with some of my perspectives. And if I can use this platform that I've been able to build to amplify the conversations that we quite naturally would be having, right? So if me and a few of my homegirls were watching the Kendrick video in a completely relaxed setting, this dialogue that would come from that, I want to bring that to your time that other people are really reacting to. And I don't feel like I have to perform outrage or say something on every issue because people are looking for me to say something, right? However, sometimes I just take the temperature of the conversation and I say, I see where this is going. I think I'm able to, at this point in my life, kind of understand all sides. So for the Kendrick video, for example, I'm sure a lot of you all have seen it, many of you haven't because you all have been at this topless grinding and hustling and networking. He released a new music video yesterday, and one of the themes that he takes on is how Black women present themselves, in particular, seeing folks in a lot of makeup and Photoshop and video magic that you see when you typically see a woman in a music video or a magazine or even Instagram photo at this point in history. You know, so erasing her stretch marks, making her look lighter, putting on weave and a lot of makeup to make yourself prettier. And there's this, on one side, you see this kind of attempt to appreciate Black women in their natural form, right? But on the other side, you also see a man who belongs to this group that is in this way privileged because there isn't an expectation that they have to go out and make their hair, that they have to go out and purchase it or alter the natural texture of their hair. Granted, the whole other conversation we have about how much you invest, alter the natural texture of their hair by wearing new rags, brushing for hours and hours. And also, there was some debate about the choice of the woman, that she was traditionally attractive. She was a brown-skinned girl. You can't quite tell if she was medium brown kind of girl. She's not white. She doesn't look biracial, but she's also a woman who would be considered beautiful in most Black spaces. Right? So, we don't necessarily need you critiquing what Cosmo or Marie Claire says about Black beauty. We're talking about relationships with Black people. So anyway, you have people saying, damn, can they try to do something good? The feminists are always messing it up. And you have people who are trying to have this kind of nuanced critique, but some of them are saying, I like the video, but I felt uncomfortable with that particular thing and I want to talk about it. So I felt I could kind of synthesize what everybody was intending to say. And remind folks that we have this platform so we can have debates.
The conversation and the dialogue on both sides. I think that's also, even what's going on in this climate, you know, Jack spoke recently and talked about how what we saw, the trends on Twitter with Arab Spring, there's similarities with that, also to the political scene with the election and the current state. It's interesting if you're watching those analytics. But also, just talking about the impact of the platform, April, creator of hashtag OscarSoWhite, and then look at what happened this year. So talk about how, you know, you've tweeted this before, and we talked about this, like, Twitter changed your life. What do you mean by that?
I can't make it any clearer than that. You know, I was, in January 2015, I was watching the Oscar nominations on a morning television show, and I was in my family room because Chris Hemsworth, who plays Thor in the Marvel series, was doing the announcing, and I said, I need him in HD. As big as I can get him. So, life size is impossible. So, I was down in the family room getting dressed that morning, and I was listening to the nominations, both for the actors and the actresses, and for those behind the camera, because those categories are just as important. Whose story is being told, how it's being told, is just as important as the faces that you see on the screen. So category after category, name after name, there weren't any people of color, people from marginalized communities. And so, you know, my phone, I am literally having an issue right now because my phone is over there and I am here. So if you see me start, this isn't nerves, this is the fact that I'm not on Twitter right now, talking about me being on Twitter. So I took to Twitter, my phone was right there, so I picked up my phone, and the very first tweet was, Oscar's so white, they asked to touch my hair. And it went viral. And I didn't know it at the time. I put my phone down, I finished getting dressed, I went on to work, picked the phone up at lunchtime, and it was trending internationally. And it was jokes, straight, you know, Oscar's so white, they love their mayo sandwiches. Oscar's so white, they wear Birkenstocks in the wintertime. And so it wasn't until a couple of days later that the conversation turned and we started having this conversation about issues of diversity and inclusion in film and entertainment broadly. And so then I needed to pivot and say,
that's not actually mine. I'll take
it. Not okay. I'll be all right. But this is a good test for me to see how long I can make it. Peel off for a second, you'll understand. I'm a functional addict, it's okay. I'm addicted to Twitter. So then I had to pivot and decide if this was going to be a thing. You know, I'm a party of one. I would love to tell this really sexy story of, you know, I was sitting around the boardroom with my team and we decided that this is what we were going to, you know, work on for the next 18 months, and we used fancy words like ideate and strategize. No, I was half naked in my family room. And that's what happened. So I needed to pivot and say, okay, this may be something, and you never know when a hashtag is going to be viral. You know, so it looked like it might be, and so I needed to get up to speed, because I was just tripping on Twitter, and then it became a thing, and now here we are 2 years later, and I'm sitting with the CEO of Twitter, like in front of 5 minutes.
And I'm sitting with you.
So, you know, all of the things that have happened for me in the last 2 years are literally because of Twitter. You know, the way that the Twitter platform works is different than Facebook. You know, Facebook, you've got one post and you're really talking about one issue at a time, and it's usually, you know, folks that are at least twice your age, and for me that means dead. And, you know, and so they just be quiet and talking about you know, but on Twitter, I can talk about the crazy stuff that Trump is doing, and the fact that Huffington's dead on Scandal, and, you know, the fact that I'm flying out to LA tomorrow. Oh, I'm sorry.
What's that? You mean something about going to LA, something about, I don't know.
You know who
is so much of what's happened with her in the last couple of years is because of Twitter. I also want to acknowledge I'm close to all three of them, and I would say in large part it's because of the connection on social media. We also have a Hill connection, but I really think that we all grew much closer, like, where are you? Let's go out for drinks, because of Twitter too. So, I mean, watch out Tinder. I'm not doing the Tinder thing, but my sister's friend.
Yes, just to be clear, it still doesn't go down in my DMs. But that's the Renaissance. That's
real. What's up?
That's part of the Renaissance, right? Like I studied African American history in college for my major by choice because everybody was like, oh, man. And I think about Harlem Renaissance, right? And I think about how many of the folks who forced Black culture, Black thinking, Black intellect, Black art, Black value into common spaces, having relationships both in public and in private. And in a lot of ways, Twitter has allowed us to do that, right? And so, when Angela's on TV, I can send a text and say, like, we did that. You know, like, we can have each other's back in a different way, often because we were able to connect with one another on these platforms. But that's how I ended up getting close in April. And I think that we recognize both the awesome responsibility and privilege of having those connections.
Absolutely. We had a student, came up to me on campus, and they said, there's no such thing as Black Facebook. There's no such thing as Black Instagram. There's no such thing as Black Snapchat, but there is a big thing, a recognizable thing called Black Twitter. So Jack, listening to that from our influencers, our Black influencers on the platform, what are your thoughts about that and Black Twitter?
I mean, that's always been our history. I think that's the most powerful aspect of the service is that, we're at the company, we're tool makers. So we're gonna make the tool and the people actually define it. It's not social media, it's not Twitter that made Ferguson Ferguson or the Arab Spring the Arab Spring. It's people that found themselves on it, and we need to make sure that we're getting out of the way so that conversation can happen. So, we've seen just like so many amazing communities, but Black Twitter has always been the most passionate, and it's because the community has found a way to bust through all the convention and just really find each other and carry one single conversation. I love what was said about post and then a comment. Like Twitter to me just flows, like it's just one single flow. And it's 24/7 flow of conversation. And the moments that inspire me are the moments where the tool is used to organize thought, to organize community, to organize action. And over our 11 years, we've just seen so much of that. And whatever we can do to make sure that we make that easier, to make it less frictionless, to make it more accessible to people. That's our current challenge right now is, we have a lot of people who have spent a lot of time on Twitter and they figured out a lot of our weirdness and a lot of our syntax, and there's a beauty to that. But that hasn't reached everyone. That hasn't been accessible to everyone. And it's our job to make sure that we have accessibility all around the world for every single community, for every person. At least they have the potential to participate.
Right.
And we need to make sure that we continue to build power into that so that anyone can pick up this microphone and have a conversation with the world without having to consider us at all. They just, they want to connect with their community. They want to connect with an idea, with an interest. And I think for a long time, we just put a lot of work in front of people. So we're taking stock of everything that causes friction, that separates people. And it goes back to that sense of openness. I think our power is the fact that the thing is just completely open, everything's on the surface, and anyone can participate with anyone else. And whatever we can do to amplify that, we're gonna do.
Absolutely. So we've got some mics, because we wanna open it up for Q&A and give you an opportunity to ask Jack questions and all of our influencers. But I just wanna also call out, trust me, these very wonderful women have already talked to Jack about an edit button, so he gets it. He got the feedback. But if there are any other questions, we have mics, and raise your hand. Yes.
To turn it really quick on the Black Twitter thing. One of the things, you all know that we're activists 24/7, so one of the things that I really like to challenge you all on is Black Twitter shouldn't just be about the conversation on the platform. Black Twitter should be what your diversity ranks look like from engineering, from marketing, from branding. I mentioned sort of branding earlier. Your board of directors, great that they're leading on there, but if Black Twitter is making it happen, there need to be more Black folks on that board. Your vendors. The other thing that I would really encourage you all to do, Microsoft and Apple had debt offerings, they use minority asset managers. The other thing that's so important, Charlamagne and I have been working on this Bank Black initiative. I would love to see Twitter say, Black folks support us. If it wasn't for Black people, we wouldn't be here. We're going to put some of our revenue in a Black-owned bank. You know, there are so many things that can be done.
Before I say my question, I want to thank all of you wonderful ladies for doing what you guys do and inspiring me to try to make a difference and help the way I can. My question, as Angela did it so beautifully a couple of days ago, is more about balancing your professionalism and your brand while also trying to keep it real and stating facts. So how do you guys go about being responsible for your brand and whoever you represent, while still keeping true to yourself and saying stuff that needs to be said?
I think you have to, that's a wonderful question. You have to be really honest with yourself. You're at the point now where you can decide, what will my brand be? Right, you barely got a brand, right? What do I want my brand to be? So we have created very unique brands for ourselves, not easily duplicated. There are a lot of other ways that you can think of yourself as a brand where you can be doing radical activist work while working in a traditional corporate setting, or being completely corporate and not being radical but having these politics that mean something to you, or vice versa, or some combination thereof. But please understand that the average person is not going to have, whether you have a big platform or a small platform, the ability to speak as seemingly freely as the ladies on this panel. And seemingly freely is an important thing to think of. We clap back, we pop off, we keep it real, we say things that are on our mind, we challenge Twitter about Twitter, right? We challenge CNN about CNN. Like, so it's not that we're not gangster and real and honest, but there's still a level to which we understand what our relationships to various brands, companies, individuals are, and how we can protect them without compromising our integrity, but also how we can be honest without compromising our ability to do the sort of work that we want to do and to be gainfully employed and paid. Because I personally don't think there's anything terribly noble about the idea of being so unapologetic and keeping it real and keeping it funny that you are unemployable. But it's a really great question.
If I could just add something. So I talk about this all the time. Audre Lorde is one of my favorite writers. And she says, if I did not define myself for myself, I would be crunched into other people's fantasies for me and keep me alive. Right? She doesn't mince any words about that. I would be crunched into other people's fantasies for me and keep me alive. Right? A lot of people will tell you what your brand is, irrespective of whether or not you have declared it yourself. So I decided two things. I decided that my brand, well, three things. One, that I would define my brand for myself, right? I don't care what you say. Here's what I can determine my brand is, because I will not be equalized by anybody. Two, though, I said that my brand has to match my values. That my brand isn't about matching the trend, it's about matching my values, right? So personally, I believe in batting and building. I believe in taking you on with my words today and going and building something for the people to be able to take you on tomorrow, right? And in order to do that, that means I can't crush you out on Twitter. I can't do it for that. I also can't do it because my mama super, right? And other people can, but my values say that I'm not going to do that, right? So my integrity matters as I build that brand. The last thing, though, is that my brand has to match my actions. Because there are a whole lot of people talking a whole lot of things, you don't do anything,
say it
and
again.
We don't have any time.
All of us are at the place now that I like to think we're in a
because everybody, as Angela said, everybody knows what you're getting with us. And so we're, there's a good chance that we won't lose our jobs because of what we say. Like, I know I get jobs because of what I say, but that's because of the brand that I built on Twitter. You all starting out are not at that place yet. So just be mindful of what you're doing, what you're saying, because you know, and I'm just keeping it real, when you send that resume out, the first thing that they're checking are your social media accounts. So get a private one, make sure it's, you know what I mean? So there are ways around that. Be true to yourself. I'm not saying censor yourself, I'm saying be intentional with what you do and make sure that you're seeking out employment in a place, if you need to, where you can say what you need to say and still pay rent in the first month.
I hope y'all are writing this down because they are speaking the truth to you all today. Monique, do you have another question here? Right here.
I have a question right here. Jack, my name is Sean Blasi. I'm the director of program management, and I live in the Bay. And one of the things that I've seen in Silicon Valley, I saw it, you know, the early 2000s, when there was a strong push when Jesse Jackson and Rainbow Push Coalition came through, and all these companies said, hey, we believe in diversity, and, you know, there's all kinds of events. Right now in the Bay as well, you're seeing a lot of companies, Twilio, Twitter, you know, there's all these companies, Code 2040, whatever, that's sponsoring diversity. But the needle is not moving. So I'm like, how long are we going to be talking about it in the Bay without seeing a change? And the second question to that is, why is the square here?
It's a good point. Like we have to put more of this in action, and we're doing we're trying to do to do even more. But I think we're still learning about what works most. And we're getting a lot of feedback, and we're getting a lot of good leadership as well. And you know, I think the first and foremost thing that we need to make sure that is that we're present and that we're listening. It's my second time at this conference. I want to come every single year. The energy here, the people here, the technical skills. And if I can keep coming, then I hope we can inspire a lot more CEOs all over the world to come as well, and then we can continue to push in and continue to invest here. One of the things that I think we've been experimenting with and trying to do at Square actually.